I will tell my story, how I become a prison guard. During that years, during apartheid, I grew up on a farm, played with African children, be friends with him. My father worked with him. We was also very poor whites because in South Africa was discrimination against blacks and whites and poor whites. So we was on this farm where the farmer have this house, and we were staying down the hill, also on a farm with Africans. So I grew up with him. One day I was disrespectful to an elderly African man. My father gave me hiding. He told me the color of the skin can't come off. He's a human being like us. We must respect elderly people. So I grew up with that intensive. So my father gets sick. We was put off the farm. We moved to the city. 1976 was uprising in South Africa. Very brutal uprising. People was arrested, shot. And I was thinking, why the black people burn their schools? I could have not understand that. And when I walked on a station, I see whites only, of blacks only. I see this discrimination. I didn't grow up with this discrimination where I grew up on the farm. I seen these things, but I didn't understand it. So a year before I left school, some of my friends left school. They go for military training because all white children was forced for military training. Go for training. And some of my friends died on the borders. We attend the funerals, and I said to myself, I'm not going to join the military at all. I look for alternatives. So I decided, they came to visit our school looking for prison guards. So I joined up as become a prison guard. I was sent for training, and from my training, they do investigation on us, your background. My father was not involved in politics. We have never political involvement at all. So I was chosen to send to Robben Island. I was one of the first youth sent to Robben Island, at least with a higher school qualification, matric. Before my time in the 60s, they employed prison guards for their size. Big guy, tall guys, strong guys, was on Robben Island. So when we arrived that evening on Robben Island, the strong guys chased us around, our youngsters. The place looked negative. Everything is half negative. The place looked old. The buildings is gray. Everything looks not good here. And so the next morning we report for duty. The head of the prison called us in. He said, welcome on Robben Island. He said, the hellhole of Robben Island, he mentioned it's a hellhole. You're going to give prisoners a hell time on Robben Island. So he said, you're going to meet the biggest criminals in the history of South Africa. These people were supposed to be death sentence, hanged, but in here for life. They're wasting our time. We must give them hell. So I was sent to the section where Mandela was being kept. I never knew a guy by the name Nelson Mandela at all. So I arrived in that section, opened the outside doors. Prisoners stand up, get ready for inspection. I see the names Walter Sisulu, Andrew Mlangeni, Nelson Mandela. I passed on, I see all life sentence. But when I passed, they greet me very friendly and polite, and I look at the faces of them, and I don't see any tattoos on their face, because gangsters is full of tattoos in South Africa. So I didn't see that at all. I passed, and later I asked the sergeant during the day after they out for exercise, I asked the sergeant, what is this criminals in for? He said, man, that's a terrorist who tried to overthrow our country. Immediately, I feel I must hate these guys, because there's the guys who killed my friend on the border. So I just carry on with my job. Mandela go out in a day, not only him, the whole group go out in a day for working. The conditions is rush on Robben Island. They work in a limestone quarry with white sand dust in their eyes. I also work there, and then we must guard them on from the hills. They work there, and the dust blow up, and sometimes you just see a glare of people. You can't even see the prisoners like they work in there, but they're singing and work together. And that was also, like Mandela said, they want to work outside because at least he can communicate with his comrades. Otherwise, they isolated one in the single cells. The single cells is so small, and Mandela lay on his mats. You've got two mats. He must all overlap the two, otherwise his feet hang over the mat of his head. His head nearly touched the one side of the wall and his feet the other side of the wall. So small is the cells. So at least when they work outside, they're out of the cells. They can see the outside world. So Mandela was in this section, and then I was sent to the censor office doing censorship. And that year, like I was 18 years old when I arrived in Robben Island, became 19. Mandela turned 60. And things were so rushed, you get thousands and thousands of birthday cards from all over the world. We had nearly 55 to 60,000 cards. I was part of the people who sort out these cards from what universities, from what places, from what countries. We look at the stamps and sort them out, recorded them down. After that, we burned all the cards because Mandela is not allowed to receive the cards. He only received 6 from his direct family. So it was for me painful to see he received all these messages. And I find out why the people outside the world know about Mandela. I don't know about this man. So when I was 1 weekend off, my uncle visited us. He asked my father for me, oh, you work on Robben Island? I said, yes. Have you seen Nelson Mandela? Is he still alive? I said, yes, I've seen him there. But my father asked, who's Nelson Mandela? He said, that's a terrorist who was charged and sentenced for life in the 60s. So when I drive back to the waterfront to get to my job on Robben Island, I see under the bridge Free Nelson Mandela. Then I do research, find out who is this Nelson Mandela. I want to know a little bit more about him. So I work in a census office, and one day we must march him down to the visiting booth. The visiting booth is outside prison, quite a distance to walk. Then Mandela walks up to a meter and a half to 2 meters in front of me. Behind me, 10 meters, is a dog handler walking with his dog. And then the guards on the post is ready geared. If Mandela tried to escape, they shoot him down. So we walked. On the way to the visiting booth, he asked me, Mr. Brandt, where you come from? I said, no, I come from the farm. You have brothers and sisters? I said, no, I don't have brothers and sisters. I play with the African children on the farm. He said, oh, that's good, that's good. So we walked, is your parents still alive? I said, yes, we are alive. We stay in Cape Town now. He said, but are you studying? I said, no, no, I'm not studying. He said, Mr. Brandt, you must start studying. On Robben Island, we want everybody to study. So we walked down, and then he to go down on his knees, he get a flower, a daisy. I think, what is he, this man doing? He put a daisy in his prison uniform at the visit. In the visit booth, it worked always like that. The window is closed in front of them, and there's no communication except on the telephone. They can speak, communicate with each other on the telephone. That moment, when the window opened, Winnie Mandela put a hand on the window, and he also touched his hand as if they touch hands. And the flower is to show that he's also a bright side on Robben Island. So Mandela had this meeting during the visit. That was the first occasion which I think, why this man is a terrorist? Why he wasn't interested in my studies? Why he's interested in my family? But I could have not understand what is about this man. Another occasion, I booked a visit for Winnie Mandela to visit Robben Island. For her, it was very difficult to visit. She must apply in writing, and then we sent her a permit. And when she received the permit, she must go to the magistrate court to apply for permission to leave her house for one day. Then she will be escorted with the police to the airport. From there, she fly down to Cape Town and escorted again to Robben Island. And because she's black, she's not allowed to sit inside the boat. Now she must sit outside. She always bring blankets and rain jackets and things because she's parked outside on the top deck. And that day it was raining, it was rough seas, bad weather. She sat in the rain. And when she arrived on Robben Island, she take the jacket off and the blankets because the air have lifted a little bit. And then we observed she got a baby infant with her. Children was not allowed to be seen by prisoners. So when she get to the waiting room, we told the ma'am, when your time for visit, you're not allowed to bring this baby into the visiting booth. And she begged, I said, ma'am, you're not allowed. The moment when she was called, she must leave the baby behind with other visitors. She have a visit with Mandela through the small tiny glass, speak on the telephone. She told her husband then that she had brought his grandchild. Immediately Mandela looked to me, asked me, Mr. Brandt, is it possible just to see the baby on a distance through the glass? My answer was no, because I can lose my job. The visit is recorded for national intelligence. Security branch want to know what the discussions is about. So my answer was no. The visit carried on. Then my superior came in and he said to me, Brandt, just tell your prisoners 5 minutes left, the visit is finished. That year, you get one visit every 3 months for 30 minutes. So I tell Mandela, 5 minutes left, you can round off your visit. And he walked on and he asked me, Mr. Brandt, please ask the warrant officer if you can see the baby. I asked the warrant officer one side, he said to me, Brandt, if you can get hold of that baby without Winnie Mandela, no, we can show him the child. So my answer was no. The window closed, visit has been taken back to the waiting room, and Mandela was just standing up and he asked me, Mr. Brandt, is it possible to pass a message to my wife? I asked Mandela, what's your message? You just have to visit. He said, I forget to tell her she must apply for visit for December. Tell a warrant officer said, rather not take the message over, let Winnie come back, because maybe she don't turn up, then Mandela said we didn't give the message. So I go to the site of Winnie Mandela. That moment, she pick up the baby from other visitors. I take the baby out. I said, ma'am, I never touch a black child. Can I hold the child for you? Push it in my arms, and then she take her handbag, want to give me money. I said, ma'am, I don't want your money. Not allowed to show Mandela the child. Mandela just want to give you a message in the visiting booth. That moment, she go in the visiting booth. I lock the side door. Locked her in, and I sneak to the side of Mandela, and he passed his message. After he passed his message, he see me on a distance in a passage, and he said, darling, I must go, in the window close, and he came straight to me. That moment, he's got tears in his eyes, he take the baby, he kiss it twice, and then Winnie knock on the door, and I take the baby out of his arms and go to the side of Winnie Mandela. She begged me, please, can show him the child? My answer was no. You know, from that moment, I feel there was a bond between us building, because you can have seen he was very thankful. He was quite emotional. I was thinking in my mind, show him this baby. That he can't smuggle the message out with the baby. The baby can't even talk. But if I should have been caught out that day, they should have charged me for smuggled with a terrorist. I should have been also in prison. I didn't think of that. So when we walked down, I was worried, and then Mandela just thanked me. He kept it a secret for many years. Only when he was present in Parliament, one day in the passage, people want to block me off. He said to the people, no, this is my warder, this is my friend. This man smuggled a baby for me on Robben Island. So he mentioned that. So I worked on Robben Island, carry on, sitting in to exams, Mandela right exams. He will always, during legal consultations, fight with his lawyers to get money from outside world. People from all over the world, churches, donate money for prisoners for studies. He wanted to change this Robben Island to a university. So he was quite busy, intensive, to help other people around him. And even put pressure to his enemy, warders who fight him, warders who do bad to him. He will tell him, sir, you must study. It's the future of this country, you must study. Then many people said, you are mad, what are you studying for? You sit in prison, what are you going to do with your studies? You can do nothing with it. You waste your money, you waste your time. So Mandela was constantly studying. You know, there was an occasion when Mandela wanted to learn our language, Afrikaans, Afrikaner language. So he started talking a little bit, and he wrote exams, practical Afrikaans, and he failed it 3 years in a row. He came to me, asked me, Mr. Brandt, I was in charge of studies that moment, can you help me, assist me, I want to manage this language. I said, Mandela, only thing is you must write essays. You must start talking. You must start reading Afrikaans. So I gave him an essay my first day on the beach. I said, Mandela, 500 words, please. So he write a long essay, when I count the words, roughly, it's over 2,000. I said, Mandela, I'm not going to read this thing. Please rewrite the whole contents for me again into 500 words. So Mandela do it again. We send it to a school. The school teacher, principal, marked it for me, put in red. He said, he can't give this prisoner at all out of 10. He can give him minus 5 out of 10 or something, because it's bad. And so I was helping, encourage him, talking. I said, Mandela, don't translate direct from English to Afrikaans. Try to listen to us, and I assist him. And the principal put letters, things forward for him, give him booklets to read. End of the day, he passed his practical Afrikaans. You know, when he was released, his first speech in Cape Town was in Afrikaans. He get the people in his hands. So I helped him with that. 1982, I want to get away from Robben Island. I'm struggling to get a transfer. At the end of the day, they transferred me. And they said, I must start working on Portsmouth Prison. That morning when I reported there, they said to me, you were too early for job. You must start 3 o'clock. You only start 3 o'clock today. I was wondering, they said night shift. That evening when I arrived there, the report for duty, they said, no, you must get a firearm. We've got 3 trucks. We've got 2 cars. We've got 5 police cars. We're going to escort dangerous prisoners tonight. I don't know from where. We're all in a truck. We just follow them and go with them. Then Mandela was transferred away from Robben Island because he take control on Robben Island to assist prisoners in studies, you know, and they're giving funding and help them. So they want to break the spirit of the ANC on Robben Island and remove Mandela and 4 of his colleagues to Portsmouth Prison. So we load Mandela in the truck, the other warders and all the escort people and some of the files and things in the truck, and we take them to Portsmouth. That night I worked night shift in a section where Mandela and his 3 colleagues was being kept. So I said, Mandela, I'm also transferred. He was very happy for me. He said, oh, Mr. Brandt, it's good that we have also our people from Robben Island with us. So I was with him there. The next morning, I must start day shift again, open a section. For them, it was really strange to be in this big cell. First time in 18 years, they slept in one big cell. They've got a proper bed. They've got pillow sheets. They've got white sheets, everything. They've got fresh water. On Robben Island, it was brackish water out of the boreholes. And it was totally different for them. And the food is a better condition. Everything was better for them, but they still have a complaint. There was only 4. They can't play tennis against each other anymore. There was not competition. There was 4 old guys. So they was isolated on Portsmouth. So I stayed with them. I work in a sense office, dealing with their visits. Still the same job in Robben Island with them. And then in 1984, they offer Mandela an offer to renounce violence and he can be walked out free. Mandela and his colleagues refuse. I gave the offer for everybody on Robben Island. They all refused. They don't want to take the offer. Then later that year, in that time on Portsmouth Prison, we become very close friends. Because when a section is locked, I'm inside. Nobody can visit us. They're on the top section of the roof of Portsmouth Prison. We play tennis with him. Our prison guards, the 3 or 4 there, play tennis with him. We play table tennis with him. We drink a coffee with him. We have nice conversations. We on Portsmouth Prison, we carry on a daily basis. A lot of small things happened. And then one day Mandela was a little bit sick. We take him to doctor, outside specialist. The specialist says they must operate his prostate. There's some cancer inside his prostate. But during that time when Mandela was in this isolation, there was times at night which they must go to him tell him, Mandela, 10 o'clock, we must take you out tonight. Kobe Kutsi want to meet you up with you. Then we give him a private suit, otherwise he must wear his prison uniform. We take him out to Kobe Kutsi. And that one evening, my wife was not at home. I sat with my baby infant at home, and I don't know what to do. And then I take my child with me to Mandela's cell. And he was so happy to see my child. He looked for some sweets, and he got only a few small sweets there, and he gave my child. From that moment, my son was really close to him also. Always I take my son into Mandela's cell, and then at least he has seen children. So there was a bond between my child, and we become friends as a family to Mandela. But also, I want to say you something in 1983. All the years till 1983, they didn't have contact visits, was through a glass. And that day in 1983, they asked us, contact visits is in place from today. We mustn't inform the prisoner. So I didn't inform Mandela. So I take him, I said, Mandela, you've got a visit. Your wife is visiting 2 o'clock. You must get ready. He's dressed up, nice, ready. When we take him to the visiting booth, I said, oh, Mandela, the visiting booth is full of criminals. Can you wait in the waiting room for me downstairs along? Take him to the waiting room. And I made him sit in. I said, another warder, just guard him here. Go to Winnie Mandela. She sat in another waiting room. I said, ma'am, they want to use this waiting room for other people now. Can you just wait in the other waiting room for us, please? And I escorted her to the waiting room. When she walked in, Mandela was still standing with his back to the door. And when he see her, he didn't know what to do. And they just hugged each other. They stand about for 5 minutes like that. And see, also have, you can see the emotion. There was tears in their eyes. The first time in more than 20 years, they have touched each other. And then I didn't know what to do, and later I said, Mandela, please, please, you can sit and relax with the visit. So he was quite emotional through that whole visit that he could have not properly communicate with her. And then we told him during that visit, from now on, all first-degree family will be contact visits. That was his first contact visit on Portsmouth Prison. So I was still in contact with Mandela after release. The day when he was released, I was so happy that he's been released. 3 days after release, he phoned my house. He spoke to my son. On another occasion, he came to Portsmouth. He visited me at my place. He wanted to see me. We were still in contact with each other. And also, when he became president, he said to me, Mr. Brandt, there's riots in your prison. You rather must come and work in Parliament. I said, man, what am I going to do? He said, no, just leave the prison service, resign, and come and work for us in Parliament. So I resigned. I go to Parliament. He made me sit there in his office. He said, you can relax here for the day. Now, everybody come and introduce me to them. And I feel in the way that I said, Mandela, I can't work like that. Then he introduced me to Cyril Ramaphosa, and I worked with the drafting of the constitution. So the new constitution, I was also part of that. The submissions was being printed, and also the constitution was adopted, and Mandela was also there. But every time when I walked in Parliament and he see me sometimes out of a meeting, he will call me. I must drink a tea with him. I must always spend time with him. He invited me to his 80th birthday when he get married to Gracia. I was on his 85th birthday. I was on his 90th birthday. A lot of occasions when he's in Cape Town after retirement, he invited me to be there. He wanted to see me and my family. So I was constantly in touch with Mandela. And then last year when he gets sick, not before he gets sick, after his book, Long Walk to Freedom, was out, he said, Mr. Brandt, I wrote about my experience in Robben Island, not about experience without us in the waters, the reconciliation between waters. Our prisoner and the water can become friends. I want you to write a book and put it in your book. And every time I have excuse about this book story, and then at the end of the day, he put Dr. James Sanders, who wrote his book for him, put it together, in touch with me. I must sign this contract because my book must be out. So they put a lady, Barbara Jones, to me. So we wrote the book last year, and then Mandela insists after he read the first 2 chapters, and the front covers, different covers, he's happy with it. He insists, he said, Mr. Brandt, I want to be at your book launch. Even if they push me in a wheelchair, I want to sit there because I want to be there. That is my passion, to be there. And the book must be out next, like last year. And then I said to Mandela, if you can't be there, who will attend my book launch? He said, then my daughter, and then Zinzi walked in. He said, Zinzi, you must go to Mr. Brandt's book launch because we are part of the family. So he insists to her, she must be there. Then Mandela becomes sick. They invited me to come and visit him in hospital. Then I spoke to Zinzi. I said, Zinzi, in what condition is he? Because I heard the media said he's so sick. They keep me up to date. She said, he's got a mask on. He's got a thing into his lungs. He's got a kidney dialysis machine on. He's quite under a lot of treatment. And I said, I don't want to see him like that. I want to remember him like I seen him last time when we talked and made some jokes. I would rather come when he came out of hospital. But he didn't come out of hospital. He passed away. But before he passed away, my book was finished. Then we decided to delay the book, totally delay the book, till after the funeral. And then I was also personally invited by the family to attend Mandela's funeral. So I was there when we put him in the grave, and I was attend the whole ceremony. And so after that, we decided to launch the book now in March in the UK it was launched. It's in 16 countries available at the moment. So Zindzi Mandela was there to attend my book launch. So for me, it was very painful the day when Mandela passed away, because always when he see me, he hugged me, and he tell the people, this is my present board and my present guard who looked after me. This is my friend. We become friends. Always like that. But for me, it was more like a father to me. You know, he was a father figure. When I was in a motorcycle accident in 1985, they claimed the insurance claim from me because they think I was a guilty person in an accident. Mandela said, no, Mr. Brandt, give me the letters. Gave him letters. He sat down and he drafted up some letters. He said, type these letters and post it off. End of the day, I won the case. Mandela won my case out of prison, my legal case for the motorcycle accident. So I was always there to help. He goes so far to smuggle the letter out of prison through my friend who worked with me, another warder, to my wife, to insist to my wife that I must study, because I didn't study at that stage. And always my wife said to me, I must start studying. I said later to her, you become like Mandela. You always pressurize me for studies. You become like him now. But she didn't tell me she received the letter. Only the day of Mandela's release, when he walked out in freedom and talking, she said, Luke, here's a letter from Mandela, in his handwriting, in Afrikaans. So you have this letter. And also he sent letters to my children to encourage them to studies. He was very fond of studies and also fond of reconciliation. And even when foreign dignitaries visit Robben Island with other countries, was cross. I said, why you invited this people and that people? He said, during our struggle, this was our friends who accommodate us when we was in exile, so we can accommodate in our country. He always want peace. He was a peacemaker. He don't want war, always peace. That's why after his release, I asked him, Mandela, don't you hate the white people of the country? He said, Mr. Brandt, I can't hate white people. I can hate the system which is in place, who oppress one by another. So all my friends is white, so he never hate the white people. So we was very close to the end. So that's why my book is, like I said, is called Mandela, My Prisoner, My Friend. Thank you.